Is God a respecter of persons? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand how many times you had anything. But stop to think about that. Does God pick and choose just because I'm the pastor that he's going to heal me and keep headaches away from me? No. Has the devil ever tried to bring a headache back to me? Absolutely. Absolutely. For about 2 seconds, I laid my hand on my head and I said, you go to hell right now in the name of Jesus and burn there forever. And it's gone. You said, well, you know, if you got a headache, try it. Tell it where to go. It's from the enemy. It's a distraction. The enemy wants to distract. If your body's in pain, right where you're sitting right now, you can be healed.
Amen.
If you can touch him. If you can touch Jesus, you can be healed. Hallelujah. She pressed through the crowd. What is the crowd that keeps you from Jesus? All the reports, and we sing that song, whose report will you believe? I shall believe the report of the Lord. What does the Lord say in his report? He said, I am the God that healeth thee. ETH. Continually heals you. Hallelujah. What an awesome God. She pressed through the crowd. She pressed through the crowd of doubt that plagued her mind with all the reports. She had gone to doctor after doctor after doctor after doctor after doctor and was no better, was worse. Some of you have been prayed for. I was talking with somebody about that this morning. And I said, it seems to me, maybe they said to me, I can't remember who said it, but it seems like the same people always have the same problem. I'm going to say this, I'm going to throw it in because I absolutely believe it with from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. It takes the same faith to keep your healing as it did for you to get your healing. At the youth congress the other night, a young man preached and there was a healing service. I think there was 18 people that said they were healed. One young man had a cast on, he had held it up. And you know, held it, waved it around. God is an awesome God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How did that happen? Somebody believed God. Somebody believed the report and made up their mind, I'm not going to stay this way. I don't have to stay this way. If God healed that person, he'll heal me. And he will. She pressed through the crowd, all the negative thoughts that came to her mind. To touch Jesus, you're going to have to press through a lot of stuff. You may have to press through religion. You may have to press through tradition that tells you sickness is God's will. It's God's will that some people get sick. It's God's will because they can be a witness for God in the hospital. I can think of better ways to give a witness than to be sick. I really can. You know, tradition. There's people, and I've been with preachers in the altar, and they lay their hand on a person and say, Lord, if it be thy will, heal this person. Tell your neighbor, it is the will of God for me to be healthy. I believe that. It's the will of God. But some people think that God's working out his mysterious will for your life through your sickness. You may have to press through ignorance in the church that tries to make you believe that poverty and humility are one and the same. That the poorer you are, the more humble you are, and the better God can use you. I'm going to tell you, the more money you've got, the better God can use you. Read this Bible. See who he chose to use in the Bible. Everybody say, he chose money people. Well then, why did he choose me? I'm the poorest of the poor. I don't have nothing. I don't have two coins to rub together. You know, I've struggled my whole life. Say this with me. Poverty is the extension of greed. That's another one you need to mark down in your little vocabulary and say it. Poverty is the extension of greed. With that, I will say that Brother and Sister Brian are going to be here, and on the Monday after Pentecost Sunday, they're going to start a Dave Ramsey course again. Those of you that have gone through it, if you want to go through it again, you're encouraged to do that. Refresh your that course in your mind. But if you have not gone through that course, I encourage you to go through it. I don't believe everything that Dave Ramsey has to say, but he says a lot of good things. And if you apply some of the things he says, it's better than having nothing. Amen. And he says that one of the things he says is pay cash for everything. Pay cash. You know, Larry Bennett is a great example of that. Came through here. I taught him Sunday school in Toledo. Came through this church. He's in Ohio now. Pastor in a church that's paid for. It's a beautiful building. You ever get to Bradner, Ohio, go see the building that Larry has got, that God blessed him with. He had a little money in savings and building fund, and he told his church board, he said, we're not going to pay one penny more than $17,000 for everything in the building. And they said, well, Pastor, we've got 20-some thousand, and we could go. He said, we're not paying more than $17,000, and God's going to give us everything in the building. And it's a beautiful building. He's got all the tables. He's got piano, organ. He's got everything, all the communion equipment, everything there. God gave them for $12,000. And then they bought a new refrigerator and bought some other stuff and paid cash for it. And I can remember Larry working at Burger King. You say, well, dude, he must have been some rich person. No, he worked at Burger King. Back in Ohio, now he's working in a prison, cooking in a prison. But, you know, in fact, he works three jobs, plus pastoring the church. 13, 14, 15. Everybody say, blessings of God. God wants to bless his people. God wants to bless us. But we get strapped with credit cards. We get bound in debt. And we can't come out of that because the borrower is servant to the lender. He has to serve that. And so, we'll say it again. Poverty is the extension of greed. Being poor, money-wise, that's not what makes you humble. You got to press through your own pride. You got to make up your mind that it doesn't matter what people think or say about you. Most important thing is, I need to touch Jesus tonight. You may have to press through the feeling barrier. You do not expect your feelings to get you to Jesus. If you listen to your feelings or your emotions, you may never reach him. You may have to press through pain. You may have to press through physical pain, emotional pain. You may have to press through the most adverse circumstances. Everything that could go wrong may go wrong in your life, but you've got to keep pressing to Jesus. One touch. If you can just touch the hem of his garment, you don't have to touch his head. You don't have to touch his heart. You don't have to touch, but the fringe of his garment, the edge of his garment. And I like this. She said to herself, what did you say to yourself before you left home tonight? What did you say to yourself before you left home tonight? Well, I don't know what I said. You need to think about it. You need to think about it. Self-talk is so important. You know, you need to check what you say to yourself and how you talk to yourself. Amen. Sometimes you've got to talk to yourself. If you wait for other people to talk to you and encourage you all the time, you may never be encouraged. You have got to tell yourself, if they can make it, I can make it. You have to have a statement, I believe in you. Look in the mirror and tell yourself, I believe in you. It doesn't matter what anybody else says, it's what you said. You know, people can talk about you, and they will. People can say all manner of things about you and against you, and they will. It doesn't matter a hill of beans what they say. It's what you say. Because you say what you believe. The Bible says, I have believed, therefore I have spoken. What you believe, that's what you speak. And so, if you think you're a loser, if you think you'll never accomplish anything, if you think you have no destiny, if you have no hope, then you're not going to keep pushing to touch Jesus. Because that's the only way you're going to get to Him. David knew the value of encouraging himself. When they returned from battle, the house had been burned with fire, their wives and children had been taken. The people became angry with David and discussed stoning him. The Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord. That's what this little woman did. 12 years. 12 years she had suffered. 12 years she couldn't sleep in the same bed with her husband. 12 years, they never had relations. They never were able to hold one another. Because to touch that body that was unclean would make him unclean also. So there was no relationship. She couldn't cuddle her children. She couldn't do anything in her home because it would make them unclean. And so she suffered alone. When you get to Jesus, is where you find another problem. Jesus was surrounded by people. People who didn't come to get anything. People that just wanted to be seen with Jesus. That way somebody would say, there's a Christian. Because they're close to Jesus. All kinds of people were touching him. Same as it is today. People were bumping into him. They were touching him physically. But her touch was different. Her touch was a touch of faith. And the touch of faith stopped Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Jesus said, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go and be whole of thy plague. Immediately, she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. In 1 minute, her life changed forever. Just one touch and years of misery and disappointment and discouragement and fear and anguish turned into joy. Hallelujah. I like the song that Brother Hooper started tonight with the service. The windows of heaven are open. God's power is falling tonight. His blessings are falling tonight. Hallelujah. You can have your umbrella up and hold those blessings off. Or you can make up your mind, I'm going to touch Jesus. And I'm not going to touch him Wednesday. I'm not going to touch him Tuesday night in discipleship class. I'm going to touch Jesus tonight. I purpose in my heart, when I left home, I'm going to touch Jesus. Hallelujah. And this is my day. Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changes. What he did for this woman, he will still do today. Whatever ailment you have, he will heal today. Whenever there are people that will press into him, they will find that he's still in the miracle working business. The blind see, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the lame walk, broken lives are restored. Livers are healed. Hallelujah. And as many people could stand tonight and say the various things that God has healed you from. My testimony is God keeps me healed. I walk in health. I walk in blessing. Hallelujah. I honor God for that. I bless him for that. Every day of my life, I thank him for his goodness. Hallelujah. Lord, I'm thankful that I'm not like, I see young men walking around with canes and you know, the had both knees replaced. And I've kicked the devil and kicked carpet and kicked and kicked and kicked and don't have pain in my legs. God is good. Amen. I testified to that to a man down in Farmington the other day at Helen Hughes' funeral. And when I got out to my truck, I got in my truck and I got a kink in my leg. I laid my hand on my knee. I said, you lying devil, get out of my truck right now. You know, I refuse your pain. Pain is from the enemy. It's not a gift from God to bless you. And I'm gonna throw this in. I'm gonna throw this in. I believe this. I believe Ed believes this. I believe Paul believes this. Listen. If I pray for you, if I anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord, and you are not healed, there is a reason you're not healed. You wanna know what that is? You have an affliction. Read James chapter 5. If any of you be sick, let him call the elders of the church, let him anoint with oil in the name of the Lord, and prayer of faith shall save his sick. In Jesus' name, that's the prayer of faith. Doing what he said to do. Let him anoint with oil in the name of the Lord, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. In Jesus' name. You don't have to pray a long-winded prayer. What did that woman say? If I can just touch, I'm not even going to pray. If I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'm going to be made whole. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. Everybody say, shall. And I love this part. And if they committed any sin, it shall be forgiven them. What an awesome God. What a giving God. What a forgiving God. What a healing God. But then it goes on and says, and if any be afflicted, let him pray. So if you have an affliction, then don't expect you to be healed when you come to me to get anointed with oil in the name of the Lord, because I can't heal your afflictions. God's not going to heal your affliction. He wants you to pray. Everybody say it's an attention giver. If you don't have a prayer room, God will create one for you. He will make one for you. He'll teach you how to pray. I appreciate the people that came to prayer last night. There was four of us here, five in prayer, and awesome prayer meeting. And I appreciate the people that came to prayer. Prayer is very important. Corporate prayer is very important. I didn't come. I quit coming to prayer meeting because I got tired of praying for you. You have to learn how to pray. My wife and I talked about this today. You know, people have to learn how to pray. It's very, very important that you learn to talk to God.
Right.
How many love God? Every person in here. Absolutely. Who's going to say they don't love God? Prayer is simply talking to somebody you love. Bottom line. Just pray. Touching Jesus is all that really matters. You can do that if you talk to him. Wherever there are miracles, it happens because somebody touched Jesus. Multitudes around the world are in church buildings every Sunday morning and every Sunday night. They move all around Jesus. They sing about Jesus. They talk about Jesus. They bump into Jesus. And yet they go out the door just like they came in. Why? Why? Because touching Jesus is all that really matters. I've got to come to the point that I make up my mind, I am going to touch Jesus, not tomorrow, not Wednesday, not some other time, tonight. Let's stand. I'm thankful to say that there is another group of people. It's a small group, but they're in every church. This group has made up their mind that they came for only one reason. They came to touch Jesus. And when they do, they turn their world upside down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My wife said to me before I left home, how are you going to end the service today? And I said, I don't know. I don't plan the ending of the service. I plan how the service is going to go. God speaks to me about what to preach. But I don't plan how I'm going to end the service. And so, this is not for everybody. But if you are, one of the sermons a young man preached down at the youth service was, I'm sick of the palsy. The night that healing happened and 18 people got healed, he said, I'm sick of the palsy. If you're sick of your situation, whatever it is, I want you to come and listen. I don't want everybody to come. I don't want you to, in fact, I want you to close your eyes so you don't see who comes and who doesn't. I want you to come and just line up across the front here. And I'm going to anoint you. And I want Paul and Ed to come, if you would, Danny, Brother Bennett.